The thing I remember most about my mother was her faithfulness to the Lord. And I don't know about you, but I wonder, what will people remember most about me? And it really won't matter, and it really doesn't matter if they remember how many sermons I preached, or how many songs I sang, or what I did here and what I did there. What I hope I can be remembered for, just as I remember my mother for, was her faithfulness and my faithfulness to the Lord. Mom did her best trying to raise us in the ways of the Lord. And I'm going to tell you something. It wasn't easy way back then to raise 10 kids. Wasn't easy. I remember when I was in high school, one of my classmates was killed in a car accident. And I didn't know at the time, but my mother had gotten in touch with that family. And once she got in touch with the family, she offered her service to them. And so she told me, she said, "You know that friend of yours that got killed?" I said, "Yeah, Mom." She said, "His funeral is in a few days?" I said, "Yeah." She said, "Well, I talked to the family, and they don't have nobody to do music. So I'm going to do the music." And she said, "Would you sing?" And I said, "Well, yeah, I guess, Mom. Yeah, we can do that. We'll do that." And so the day of the funeral came, and Mom was there at the organ, and she played a while, and then I sang a song. And at the time, I really didn't know what effect that had on the family. But a couple of weeks later, I got this letter from the family. It came to my high school, addressed to me. And here's what the letter said. October 7th, 1974. Here's what the letter said. This is from the mother of the young man that was killed. The mother said this: "Dear Jerome, I've struggled for better than 2 weeks now to try to find just the right words to, in some small way, express our family's gratitude to you and your mother for adding so much to Larry's funeral service with your music. I've come to the conclusion that there's no way we could ever begin to tell you how very much it meant to us, nor is it in my power, at least, to find enough words of thanks. This may sound trite, but we were so deeply touched that you thought enough of Larry to offer to sing that old lovely hymn at the service. We had never had a funeral in our close family, and we really hadn't any idea as to what plans had to be made. In fact, if your mother hadn't called, I'm sure we wouldn't have had any music at all. So I am doubly grateful to you both. Larry thought a lot of you, Jerome. And I even remember telling your dad about it one day when he was down at Byrd Oxygen where I work. I hope it will serve as some kind of thanks if I tell you that I can now understand why he thought you were so great. Sincerely, Betty Nelson. This letter came to me. I was a sophomore in high school. And as I said to you earlier, I didn't know that Mom had contacted that family about doing something there in the service. But she did. And because she did what she did, it seems to me that the family was grateful and God was glorified.
Amen.
And that's what really meant the most to me. As believers in the Lord, we're called to live a life of faithfulness.
Amen.
And folks, I want you to know that's not going to be easy. That's not going to be easy because Jesus said this. Jesus said, if they persecuted me, they are also going to persecute you. He said, the servant is not greater than his Lord. So in other words, whatever happens to the Lord is going to happen to the servant. Jesus was mistreated. So guess what? We're going to be mistreated. Jesus was lied on. We're going to be lied on. He was talked about. We're going to be talked about. Now, I want to be faithful, but I can't be faithful in my own strength. That's why the Apostle Paul wrote in Ephesians chapter 6, Paul said, be strong in the Lord. That's where our strength comes from. Be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Because I don't have any strength of myself. I don't. Whatever strength I have, it comes from above.
Amen.
Be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. I don't have it, but I know where I can get it.
Amen.
I know who I can turn to in my time of trouble. I know there's someone that I can look to when I'm feeling weak.
Yeah.
And I can't seem to find my way. Anybody ever been there? You just can't seem to find your way. And you're struggling and you're not really sure what you're going to do. Oh, I think we've all been there sometime or another. And so I realize that there is someone that will give me exactly what I need. I'll get the strength to just go on a little bit further. Because you see, folks, my hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. And I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name.
Amen.
On Christ, the solid rock, I stand.
Amen.
Because all other ground, guess what? Ain't up a sinking sand.
Amen.
All other ground is sinking sand. When I was growing up in church, I was surrounded by mothers who were faithful to the Lord. Now, almost all of those mothers have gone on to be with the Lord. But their legacy lives on. That legacy lives on. I was telling Bruce and his sisters last week as they were leaving church. I said, you know, guys, your mother would be so proud to know and see y'all in church. Yeah. I told him that last Sunday. I told him that last Sunday. Your mom, and they just like that, they just grin. Because they know I'm right. And now Louie's sitting up in here today. You know, Mary Jones. That was her name. Mary, and she did a little thing. She did a little thing. But let me tell you something about that lady. She loved her some Jesus. She loved Jesus. And it just flowed from her. It just flowed from her. And it made all the difference in her life. And she did the best she could to show her children who Jesus was. But I thank God today that we still got some mothers who love Jesus. We still got some mothers who are pointing the way to the cross. Thank God for those mothers. And many of you are here today. And I'm grateful to God that you keep doing what you're doing. You got some hard-headed children, amen. Amen. But you know what? If you just keep on living the life, you just keep on being faithful. Because faithfulness is the key. Keep on being faithful. Keep on doing what the Lord has called you to do. And now, because of the faithfulness of mothers long ago, we're beginning to see how their children are slowly beginning to turn now. And some to come back to the Lord. And when you see that, that is yet another testimony of how that mother's legacy lives on. Now, we notice here that Jesus promises to reward those who are faithful to him. Do you see that there? Look at that 10th verse once again. Jesus promises to reward those who are faithful to him. Notice what he says there in the last part of verse 10. Be thou faithful unto what?
Death.
Now, listen. When we think about death and being faithful to death, we're thinking in our mind, hopefully, we're going to live a long time. And you know, maybe into our 70s and 80s, if not maybe even longer. We're hopeful that we'll live a long time, and then one day the time is going to come where we will lay down and die. But check this out. This church called Smyrna that Jesus is addressing in this letter, they're not thinking about death way down the road. They were facing death right then and there. And so when he said, be faithful unto death, he knew he was talking to a people who soon would die. Because in that time, they had this thing called emperor worship. Whoever the Roman emperor was, that's who the people were commanded to worship. Well, the believers in Smyrna said, oh no, we're not going to worship a man. And we don't care who the man is. Well, this man, he can have you put to death. He's He's got that kind of power from a human standpoint. He can have you put to death. And the believers there in the church at Smyrna, they knew that. And many of them were martyred, were put to death because they would not worship the emperor. So for them, hearing those words being read to them in this letter from the Lord saying, be faithful unto death, they already knew they were facing death. They knew for the most part it was imminent. And what did Jesus say to them? Be faithful. Be faithful. Be faithful. So for us, none of us knows when death is going to come. Do we? We don't know when we breathe it's going to be our last breath. We don't have a clue when that might happen. And so in a sense, we're all facing death, aren't we? We really are. But death, in this sense, is not so much the threat from a government to come and take our life. That's not so much the threat that we have to be concerned about. But we do have to be concerned about the fact that any moment, at any time, this old heart could just stop. And it doesn't matter how young we are. Y'all remember one of our children told about their teacher? Is your teacher, Crystal? Is that who it was? She came home to tell us that her teacher, husband, went into the bedroom to wake up their 9-year-old girl. And she didn't wake up. Had been sick, had no health issues, and to this day, they still don't have a cause. They just said, natural causes. She just died. We don't get any guarantees, do we? That's why, whatever you're going to do for God, you better do it now. And do all you can, while you can, and be as faithful as you can. Amen. I ain't gonna knock this plan over, y'all, so I'm gonna step back. I'm waving my hands all over the place. Be faithful. Now, that also means things are gonna happen in your life to challenge you. Things are gonna come your way you don't expect. Circumstances and situations are going to surround you that come from out of nowhere. So how are we going to react to it? What are we going to do? You going to get mad at God? Some people do. Get mad at God and quit church. How sad is that? How sad is that? Whatever we go through, I told you a few weeks ago, whatever you go through, that's what you grow through. Okay? God is wanting to grow us and mold us and shape us and help us to realize the importance of faithfulness. So folks, that's our challenge. There is that call to faithfulness. And as I said before, I want to say it again. I'm so thankful for faithful mothers. And as I was growing up, like I told you, I'm just surrounded by it. I could just turn around here, turn around there, turn around there, and I could point out a faithful mother. I just could. And I'm grateful for those of you mothers today who who continue to remain faithful to the Lord.
Amen.
It really makes a difference. It really means a lot.
Amen.
Paul, the great apostle, said, "For to me," or in other words, he was saying, "As far as I'm concerned, for to me to live is Christ. To die is to gain. To die is gain." In other words, he's saying, if I live for Christ, I win. If I die with Christ, I win. People that tell me, "Well, that's a win-win situation." You better win.
Right.
That's the best win-win situation you could ever have. He said, "Look, if I live for Christ, hey, I win. When I die, having lived for Christ, when I die, I win again. I can't lose. I can't lose. Absolutely no way." And so I hope today you and I can echo those words of that great apostle. I hope that you and I can say, as far as I'm concerned, for me to live is Christ. Life in Christ goes hand in hand. Because if I'm living for Him, then I really know what life is all about. For me to live is Christ. Mike Reese was talking about his dad and mom and how much they meant to him. But he'll tell you now, his relationship with God means more than that. Means more than that. And you know he's crazy about his folk. You know that. Crazy about it. But Christ must be our life. For me to live is Christ. Now, some people, that here's what they say. For me to live is money. For me to live is success. For me to live is prosperity. For me to live is stuff, things. That's the way some people are. For them to live means all of that temporary stuff that doesn't last. I don't know what it was, but I saw on the news recently, and I tried to get more information on the internet, and I thought about it last night, about the man in Florida who burned up his house, killed his wife, killed his two children, then killed himself, living in a rented mansion. Now, we say, "Oh, they must have it made." When we see these houses people live in, we say, "Oh, how nice that must be. Oh, got all of this and got all of that, but ain't got no peace. Ain't got no hope." And you know what? If you don't have peace, if you don't have hope, you ain't got nothing. I don't care how much money you got. And I don't know, they're speculating now, was this man's, you know, was his finances, was they about to, you know, it could have been they were about to fall apart. But you see, at the end of the day, he didn't have any hope. He didn't have hope. And because he didn't have hope, when whatever he was putting his hope in was gone, he felt, what's the use? And so, four lives destroyed. Four lives. And the innocence of his family. But see, that's what happens when your trust trust is put in the wrong things, when your faith is in the wrong place, and your life to live is houses and land. That's your life. And if there's a threat and that stuff can be gone, then you don't see any reason to live. How tragic. And they said that the shooting occurred so fast that the people that he killed didn't even have time to react. How sad. Because when you don't have hope, when you don't have Christ, then life really doesn't make sense. Life really doesn't have meaning or purpose. And so you conclude wrongly, you conclude falsely, I'm just going to end it all. Okay, you might do that for you. Why you gotta bring others down with you? How tragic. How sad is that, though? The church at Smyrna was a poor church from a material standpoint. They were poor. In fact, few people owned possessions. And many were slaves. Many members of that church in Smyrna were slaves, and most of them were destitute. Notice how Jesus describes them. Notice how Jesus describes them. Let's look again here. He says, now, in verse number 9, he says, I know your works and tribulation and poverty. But notice there, Jesus says, but thou art rich. Now, wait a minute, Lord. You just said you know their poverty. Now you're saying, but you are rich. Jesus, which one is it? Either they rich, which one is it? Well, Jesus said, in worldly standards, you're poor. But in godly standards, you're rich. Y'all looking at a poor rich preacher. Can I tell you that? Y'all looking at a poor rich preacher. Amen. I don't have to have them preachers in L.A. got, okay?
All right.
Y'all making sure of that. I don't have to have a dad. I really don't. Now, I want to live. I want a roof over my head. Don't get me wrong. Some nice things, but I don't need all the glamour. I don't need all the glitter. I really don't. Because you know what? It's going to stay here one day. It's going to all be left behind. And then somebody else who probably ain't going to even appreciate it like that. So you know, I just say, Lord, whatever you give, however you want to do it, it's okay with me. Because you know what? You see, look, he said, hey, I got a crown for you. I got a crown for you. And he said that to that church, you be faithful unto death, and I will give you a crown. Now, I think that crown of life is really eternal life. I think that's what that crown is. Because in Smyrna and in the surrounding areas there, they often played athletic games. In fact, in ancient Greece is where the Olympic Games started.
Yes.
That's where they started.
Yes, it is.
And you didn't have gold, silver, or bronze medals then. They gave you wreaths or crowns if you won your race.
All right.
You got a crown. Paul says here, you ain't seen the crown until you see the crown Jesus got for you. It is that glorious crown of everlasting life. And I don't know why it is that fools don't get happy about eternal life. But I get happy about it. Thinking about how I'm going to be with my Savior and my Lord forever and ever, seeing Him face to face in all of His glory.
Yes.
I get excited about that. I get excited about that. And to think that I get to look into the eyes of eternity. I get to see the one who took those nails, who wore that crown, who hung on that cross for me. I get to see you. And I hope you don't mind if I just stand there and look at it.
All right, sir.
I'm sure eventually I'll fall down at his feet and I'll praise him. But I hope you don't mind, brothers.
Yes.
Friends. If I can just look at it.
Amen.
If I can just see your face.
Yes.
And to be in his presence.
Hello.
With all of his glory.
Amen.
I couldn't stand it in this flesh. That's why we have to have that spiritual body that he's prepared for us.
Amen.
In order to be in that atmosphere called heaven. In that glorious place where we will see and be with our Savior. Now, our loved ones who have served Christ, Jones, they'll be there.
Yeah.
If heaven's got an organ, I think I know who's playing.
All right.
I think if they got one. But you know what? Listen. We will not know each other as we knew each other here. Okay? Hear me? Our moms, our loved ones who have gone before us, yes, they'll be in the presence of the Lord. We'll be there with them. But it won't be like they're our moms anymore. Because that need that we had for them here on earth, we're not going to have that need. No, we'll know them. And we'll love them. And we'll remember them. But it's going to be vastly different. Because we truly then will know one another and love one another as true brothers and sisters.
Amen.
In the Lord. We really will. And that same, and the same way goes for husbands and wives. Same thing. You know, I love my wife. But in heaven, it's going to be different.
Yeah.
It's going to be different. It won't be like, okay, y'all, it's time to go home. We are home.
Yeah.
We are home. You don't need to go anywhere. We're home. Because we're with our Savior. And the Bible says that there isn't going to be any night there.
Right.
No night. just, one day, that just keeps lasting.
Yes, sir.
One day, that just because he's there,
yes,
that is the light of that place called heaven. Won't need the sun anymore, because his presence will brighten it enough.
Glory.
His presence will be brighter than a million suns. That's who we're talking about, y'all. That's who we're called to be faithful to.
Yes.
And that's what I want to do. I want to be faithful. I want to be faithful. So I'm going to bring this to a close here. Listen. You are rich.
Yes.
Oh, yeah. You are rich today.